It's a pleasure being here. I want to thank Professor Strang for inviting me, and I want to thank Dean Barris and all of you for coming and for tolerating a point of view, at least so far, tolerating a point of view that's obviously pretty controversial in many circles. But I welcome the Q&A and the opportunity to hear any challenges to what I'm saying and have a chance to respond to them. My talk will focus on just one of the many problems that I see with racial preferences in university admissions. The cruelest consequence, I submit, of those racial preferences is not to white or Asian students who don't get into the school they wanted to get in, it's to the grievously damaged victims of large racial preferences. I emphasize large, and I'll come back to that. Who are the supposed beneficiaries, especially African Americans, because I think there's a lot of, I think the lasting harm that's done by this system is done primarily to the supposed beneficiaries, not to the whites or the Asians. First, a quick digression about the misleading nature of the phrase affirmative action. It is typically used as a synonym for racial preferences, not only by the media and not only by supporters of racial preferences, but also, unwisely, I think, by many critics of racial preferences like me. The reason I think it's misleading is that polls show a large percentage of the American people overwhelmingly disapprove of racial preferences when the poll is framed in that, or if the poll is, should race be considered in college admissions? Large majorities disapprove. But when the question is, do you support affirmative action or variants of that? It's much closer, it's much more ambivalent. I'd say majorities still disapprove, but it's not nearly as lopsided. Now, why is that? The reason is that I think many people who react more positively to the phrase affirmative action recall and approve, as I do, the original meaning of that phrase, affirmative action. It did not mean or even amount to or even allow racial preferences. Affirmative action was originally defined in two famous executive orders by Presidents Kennedy and Johnson to mean energetic, proactive efforts to prevent discrimination against minorities and to correct past patterns of exclusion. And, you know, the language of it says no racial discrimination. Racial preferences are a form of racial discrimination. But rather quickly, the term evolved and became used synonymously with affirmative action, and you may have noticed that I'm using the very phrase that I criticize in the title of my book, How Affirmative Action Hurts Students It's Intended to Help. And the reason is that I think through years of acculturation and propaganda, if I may put it that way, the phrase racial preferences has become jarring to many ears. But today I'm going to call racial preferences what they are, which is policies that admit students of preferred racial groups, mainly African Americans and Hispanic Americans, ahead of academically better qualified white and especially Asian students. Unlike true affirmative action, racial preferences typically prefer economically well-off, as well as not so well-off, African Americans and Hispanics over working class and poor, as well as more well-off, Asians and whites, who are less wealthy and better qualified academically. Think about that for a minute. It's not the major point of the mismatch argument, but it's an important point. The arguments that racial preferences are unfair to whites and Asians have been familiar for over 40 years, and I'm not going to rehash them today. All the while, the use and political entrenchment in elite circles of racial preferences has become stronger and stronger. Mismatch theory has been a less familiar critique of racial preferences until recent years, but it is increasingly seen by experts and shown by empirical research to be the most powerful critique. Racial admissions preferences are used by almost all selective universities and colleges in the United States, but not by all schools, and maybe not by the University of Toledo, from what little I know. And I don't know much, but I do have a strong sense that the very large racial preferences that I'm mainly attacking are not present here. Whether that's right or wrong, I'll go on. But when racial preferences are light, balance tipping, tie breaking, fingers on the scales, closely matched applicants, and we'll take this one rather than that one on account of race. As most universities would have us believe, they don't cause serious mismatch problems. Imagine, for example, College X has a mean SAT score gap between black applicants and, I'm sorry, not applicants, people they accept, students, and whites of 50 points. Mean racial gap in high school grades of a fraction of a grade point. The black students would be quite capable of competing academically with perhaps a little extra effort to catch up. The problem is that the racial gaps in academic preparation and ability at the vast majority of selective colleges in this country are huge, and that has huge costs. A foreseeable but widely denied and widely concealed result is that Hispanic and especially black students, because the racial gaps are bigger with black students, tend to be unprepared for and shocked by the academic challenges they encounter in colleges where they are not competitive academically with their classmates. They are set up to fail by being brought without warning into highly competitive settings where they are likely to struggle academically, become demoralized, lose intellectual self-confidence, and drop out of academically challenging courses that are gateways to some of the most desirable professions. Why is that? How does it work? I'll just take a hypothetical example. I was pretty good in math in high school. If I had gone into the toughest math course at Princeton University, which was full of math geniuses, and I was not a math genius, I'd have been lost within 2 days. I'd have been flunking the first test. I'd have been out of there pretty fast. Not because I'm not good at math. I was very good at math. But because I can't compete with people who are very, very, very good at math. And because teachers and professors tend to calibrate the pace of their instruction to how fast the median person in the class can handle it. So if a unit of calculus is a breeze for some of these math geniuses and they can do it in a week, maybe I need 2 weeks or 3 weeks, but they're not going to give me 2 weeks or 3 weeks. That's kind of a little vignette of how the mismatch problem works. It has more to do with the inability to learn things as fast as the kid in the next seat than it does with the inability to learn things, period. Let me catch where I am. Yeah, so mismatched students, apart from academic difficulties, tend to become isolated and often alienated from more successful students who socialize mainly with other successful students. There's been scholarly research that confirms this. It never quite, frankly, had occurred to me, but scholarly research shows it's very isolating and has a lot to do with self-segregation. So the racial preference admits are victims of what we call mismatch. They would do much better academically, and substantial evidence suggests perhaps in their careers, perhaps lead happier lives. That's not provable. It's a perhaps. If they attended less selective but still competitive schools for which they are well prepared. This is not to deny that some black and Hispanic students compete very successfully at the very highest levels. President Obama is an obvious example, president of the Harvard Law Review. And there are lots of examples, some of whom are critics of affirmative action of racial preferences. Thomas Sowell, the original great black critic of racial preferences. Shelby Steele is another one. John McWhorter is a third. Now consider, as a for example, the case of Jerome Hall. He breezed through high school in Syracuse, New York, in the top 20% of his class. He'd been class president, a successful athlete. He sang in the gospel choir. He was easily admitted to Colgate, a moderately elite liberal arts college in rural New York. No one pointed out to Jerome Hall that his SAT scores and his grades were far below the class median. Not so much his grades, but adjusted for high school quality. Hall immediately found himself over his head academically, facing far more rigorous coursework than ever before. And here are quotes from him. We interviewed him. A friend of mine did the interview. I wasn't present, but it's in our book. Quote, "Nobody told me what would be expected of me beforehand," he recalls. "I really didn't know what I was getting into, and it all made me feel as if I wasn't smart enough," end quote. Just as surprising and upsetting was the social environment in which he found himself. Quote, I was immediately stereotyped and put into a box because I was African American. And that made it harder to perform. People often made little derogatory comments. There was a general feeling that all blacks on campus were there either because they were athletes or they came through a minority recruitment program and might not really belong there. That was just assumed right away. And the assumption, although a cruel one, had a lot of truth to it. That's why racial preferences are an extremely powerful generator of racial stereotypes about academic abilities, because of the division between different racial groups on the same campus. Jerome Hall was forced by bad grades to drop out after his freshman year. I'm glad he did eventually return to Colgate and obtain his bachelor's degree, but at considerable cost, I think, to his happiness and self-esteem. Now I'm going to talk about how large racial preferences doom mismatched students to academic struggle. I've made the general point. I'm going to detail it. Mismatch theory rests on a foundation of facts that are undisputed among experts, although hidden from view by academia, the news media, and the federal government. Mismatch theory is also winning far more acceptance in scholarly circles than it originally had, when first in the 70s, when Thomas Sowell anticipated everything we've learned since then, and then more recently when my co-author Richard Sander in 2004 touched off an explosion in the law schools by publishing a law review article. Now there have been more than 20 peer-reviewed articles by eminent scholars in important journals developing various aspects of mismatch theory, especially in sciences. And the number of peer-reviewed articles criticizing mismatch theory, the last time I checked, was zero. Dozens and dozens and dozens of articles attacking mismatch theory, not one peer-reviewed article. The cornerstone of mismatch theory are the scientifically indisputable facts that the racial preferences used by most universities and the corresponding racial gaps in academic preparation within each school's entering class are enormous. How enormous? According to a leading study, a book by Thomas Espenshade and Alexandra Walford Radford, the mean SAT scores at each major group of highly selective schools, they had a sampling. Blacks averaged 450 points below the Asian mean on a 1,600-point SAT score. Blacks averaged 310 points below the white mean and 180 points below the Hispanic mean. This isn't true at every school. It's probably least true at the most selective schools. Harvard probably has much smaller gaps than that. But this was an average among highly selective schools. By the way, I neglected to mention that apart from scholarly acceptance, mismatch theory has also received favorable comments, I'd say, since 2013 by three Supreme Court justices. Chief Justice John Roberts and Justices Clarence Thomas and Antonin Scalia, of course, all conservatives, indicating that they are aware of and interested in the mismatch problem. Scalia referred to a brief that Rick Sander and I had filed in the case at hand, in the Fisher case, not by name, but I wish I had had a chance to revise the way he said what he said, because it was said very badly. A friend of mine who's a friend of his called and said, "It's all my fault, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry." I said, "What are you talking about? Did I forget to send you a holiday card? What's going on here?" "No, no, no, I told Scalia he had to read your brief on mismatch, and then he butchered it." And he sort of did. Let me move down. By the way, the gaps in high school grades are similar to the gaps in SAT scores or ACT scores, adjusted for high school quality. Obviously, an A at some high schools is not the same as an A at other high schools. Many black and, to a lesser extent, Hispanic students cannot keep up with better prepared classmates and rank low in their classes no matter how hard they work because of the racial preferences. They would do fine at a school where they had the same entering credentials as their classmates. Some 25 to 50% of black students at most selective undergraduate schools rank in the bottom 10% of their classes academically. In law schools, about half of black students rank in the bottom 10% of their classes. And the bottom 10% is a bad place to be. Graduate schools, don't really want people who are in the bottom 10% of their class. Employers aren't that interested in people with exceptions in the bottom 10% of their class. And these, I think it's really important to emphasize, these academic struggles have nothing to do with race as such. The rich son of a white donor of $3 million to a fancy university, who's admitted despite weak qualifications, has the same problems. There aren't as many people like that, but they have the same problems. If you enter college with less academic preparation than your classmates, these kind of problems a lot less are likely to happen. Athletes, a lot of athletes have the same problems. The reality is that most good black and Hispanic students who would be competitive in many schools are not competitive at the more selective schools to which they are admitted via racial preferences. As a result, we have fewer, we think we probably have fewer, can't say we've proven this to a scientific certainty, but we think we have fewer black and Hispanic lawyers, fewer doctors, fewer scientists, fewer engineers, fewer professors than we would have if admissions were race neutral. It wouldn't push anybody out of college. If you made admissions race neutral, the subtraction of, you know, how many fewer black students would be at, would there be at college? I think it's maybe zero. It'd be at different colleges, a lot of them. Then there's the pervasive dishonesty at the heart of the racial preference regime. Selective schools systematically deceive, not to say defraud, their affirmative action recruits by telling them that they are well qualified, while failing to disclose that most will rank near the bottoms of their class and be unable to pursue aspirations for careers in professions requiring exceptional academic performance. These universities also conceal from racial preference recruits that their chances of entering and succeeding in such professional fields would be greater if they attended somewhat less selective schools where they would be more competitive with their classmates. I'm going to detail that on science mismatch, law school mismatch, and faculty diversity. The percentage of black students entering college who aspire to be scientists is slightly higher, not a lot higher, than among whites, lower than Asians, higher than among whites. And a great many black students also hope for careers in medicine, engineering, other professions that can be reached only by competing successfully in the toughest undergraduate courses. But these black students, those who are mismatched, flee tough courses in highly disproportionate numbers to soft courses such as sociology, black studies, easily graded courses, according to some of the most striking empirical research on mismatch effects, something like five excellent peer-reviewed articles on science mismatch. None of them have ever been seriously disputed by anyone, as far as I know. Indeed, large racial preferences place the best minority science students in the schools where they are at least likely to achieve their goals. This has been copiously documented by Rogers Elliott at Harvard in 1996 and in several more recent studies. And historically, black colleges and universities produce a highly disproportionate percentage of the black PhDs with blacks with, I'm sorry, bachelor's degrees in science and engineering, even though they account for only 20% of black students. And there are quotes, and I won't read them, from professors at those schools saying, you know, these schools that are pulling students that could do very well here into elements where they can't do very well are doing a lot of damage. In law schools, according to a careful study in January 2015 by Peter Arcidiacono of Duke and Michael Lovingham of Cornell, who's a mismatched skeptic, they got together to try and produce something that couldn't be attacked as coming from a point of view. And they came down with a study that was pretty supportive of mismatch research, but one little factoid in their study is at the University of Virginia and University of Wisconsin law schools, for example, the median black admit had an academic index, you know, LSAT scores and grades factored together, that would place him below the first percentile of the white admit at the same school. Black law graduates flunk the bar exam at four times the white rate. Even when compared with whites who have very similar undergraduate academic records and LSAT scores, blacks flunk the bar exam at twice the white rate. Why would that happen? Why would academic clones, this group white, that group black, have dramatically different performances after they go through law school and take the bar exam? We submit that the overwhelming evidence is because the blacks are in the wrong law schools. They are learning less. They are becoming discouraged. And the bottom line is, and my co-author Rick Sander has done careful calculations, fewer than half of African American entering law students ever pass the bar exam or ever become lawyers. These students are, in many cases, wasting 3 years of their lives and untold sums of money based on being misled into thinking you're going to do well at this law school, when the fact is that they're not going to do well, most of them. Mismatch victims and campus unrest is kind of my next section. Why were some of the most privileged students in the nation plunged last fall into racial grievance culture and upending their campuses as though oppressed by Halloween costumes they don't approve at Yale, by portraits of Woodrow Wilson at Princeton, by possibly fabricated racial epithets at Missouri, by imagined microaggressions everywhere? The reasons are, of course, multifaceted, but a major reason is that many or most of the African American student protesters really are victims, but not of old-fashioned racism. They're victims, as I've explained, of the very large admissions preferences and academic mismatch at the selective universities that have misled them into thinking they are well qualified to compete with their classmates, who are in fact far stronger academically. Put yourself in the position of a black or Hispanic student in that, you know, who's been admitted via a large racial preference. You may work heroically during the first semester only to be lost in many classroom discussions. It's moving too fast. And dismayed by their grades, as they start to see the gulf between their own performance and that of most of their fellow students, dismay can become despair. They soon realize that no matter how hard they study, they will struggle academically. It's critical to understand that these are not bad students. They're good students. They did well in high school. They could succeed at somewhat less selective universities, where they would arrive roughly as well prepared as their classmates. But as would be true if I had gone to Caltech and taken hard physics courses, they're not competitive with their classmates in many cases because of the racial preference system. Due to racial preferences, they find themselves for the first time in their lives competing against classmates who have had a huge head start in terms of previous education, academic ability, or both. This, in turn, increases these mismatched students' isolation and self-segregation from the higher achieving Asians and whites who flourish in the more challenging courses. Research shows that racial preference recipients develop negative perceptions of their own academic competence, which in turn harms their performance, even their mental health in some cases, through stereotype threat and other problems. They may come to see themselves as failures in the eyes of their families, their friends, and themselves. Such mismatched students are understandably baffled and often bitter by why this is happening to them. With most other minority students having similar problems, their personal academic troubles take on a collective racial cast. Research shows that racial preference recipients develop negative perceptions of their own academic competence, which in turn harms their performance. I'm sorry, I repeated that. Consider the anguish of Imani Marshall, a senior pre-med student, highly selective Amherst College in the Northeast, who I read about in the New York Times. Ms. Marshall started to cry at a protest gathering last November when another young woman said she went to sleep at night wishing she would not wake up. An African-American Ms. Marshall had graduated from a selective public school in Chicago and was on full financial aid. But she told the New York Times reporter that she felt unprepared academically and socially for Amherst. She was also reluctant to ask for help, lest she undermine the standing of African Americans. Ms. Marshall told the reporter, quote, "I feel like an imposter. I close myself off a lot of times from help. I always feel like I need to prove to other people that I do belong here," end quote. Her anguish is understandable. She mentioned no experience of racism. I don't know, she may have had some experience of racism, but none of it was discussed in that New York Times interview. I suspect she was a victim of her school's failure to warn her about the mismatch problem I've been discussing. Next, I'll talk about mismatch denialists and why they were wrong. A great many scholars with prestigious resumes, aggressive ideologies, and an invincible disregard for facts and evidence have criticized mismatch theory, attacking our Supreme Court brief, which we filed, attacking our book, and mainly attacking us, even though not so much attacking the other 20 peer-reviewed scholars who have taken this position. They went after my co-author, Rick Sander, first, and they prefer to go after him rather than to go after an army of people whose research supports him. From the sheer number of these critics and the volume of their writing, one might think they have a parable case. They don't. No serious empirical scholar has even attempted to question any of the major elements of mismatch theory, with two exceptions that I'll note. At first, I understand that one of these may be coming here to criticize my point of view as statistically unsound and disproven. And if it's the argument that I've heard before in a brief by the so-called Brief of Empirical Scholars in the Supreme Court, two briefs, I won't mince words. The arguments are dishonest, deeply dishonest. The people signing the brief would have known the arguments were dishonest if they had read it, which I suspect most of them did not. And Rick Sander, my co-author, felt strongly enough about this that he's issued more than once public challenges to any of the scholars who have attacked our work to have a debate refereed by a mutually agreed panel of empirical studies scholars. Rick has also offered to pay gratuitous $10,000 in cash to the opponent if the judges decide that the opponent won. I hereby join and reaffirm that challenge to whoever may come here. Specifically, no serious scholar has challenged the study showing the following, and they sort of ignore these and try and challenge other things. The racial preferences at almost all selective schools are very large, undisputed among serious scholars. Students admitted via large racial preferences get low grades on average, undisputed. A highly disproportionate percentage do badly in science, pre-med, and other challenging courses, undisputed. They drop those courses and abandon their aspirations to have careers in those fields in highly disproportionate numbers, undisputed. A catastrophically high percentage of preferentially admitted law students either flunk the bar the first time or never pass the bar. The only even remotely plausible criticisms of mismatch theory involve legitimate dispute and doubt about what my co-author Rick Sander calls the secondary effects of mismatch, in particular graduation rates, post-career college success, and to some extent, bar passage rates. Graduation rates, it's commonly observed that, hey, you look at students with similar high school credentials and scores, and this one goes to the prestigious place, and that one goes to the less prestigious place because he wants to stay close to home, and the ones who go to the prestigious places have higher graduation rates. That's true. The reason is that the prestigious places try very hard never to fail out anybody. And so, yeah, it's true, and you can get the degree, but in terms of learning something or getting above the bottom of your class, it's not doing much for you. Bar passage, there are complicated statistical arguments whether the very high rates of black failure that I've described are caused by mismatch or something else. And I think it's pretty clear they're caused by mismatch, but there are a lot of people who argue the opposite, and we're happy to debate them. Career success, much more complicated. It's very probable that some preference recipients benefit in the long run and others suffer. And there are no publicly available data from which one could draw confident conclusions about whether those who suffer on balance are closer to 80% or 20% of the student population of all preference recipients. That's the data that would allow one to draw conclusions. I'm not sure you could ever have such data, but we don't have them now, and I'll get to that in a minute. These critics suggest that a degree from an elite school brings valuable prestige. Undoubtedly true. But some studies suggest that black students who do well at less elite schools, but are high in their class, have more successful careers than, on average, obviously, than those who do poorly at more elite schools. And consider the long-term effects on intellectual self-confidence of the experience I've been describing. I couldn't prove it. There are no scientific studies that really prove it, but it seems to me a very important consideration, even if you do have a fairly successful career. The most highly touted argument that preferences are an unalloyed benefit, The Shape of the River, a 1998 book by Derek Bach and William Bowen, is misleading to the point of dishonesty in its use of statistics. I won't elaborate on that because I'm running out of time, but here's a very intelligent point. The Mismatch denialists and their allies, all of them as far as I know, furiously resist every effort to make public or even available to scholars on a confidential basis the ample data that might either support or undercut Mismatch theory. The California State Bar, for example, has mountains of data that would go a long way towards either proving Rick Sanders right or proving he's wrong. And it's not an accident that the person who's filing a lawsuit to force the California Bar to make that data public is my co-author Rick Sander. And the people who are furiously opposing it are the Mismatch denialists. I think I know why. I think they know what the data would show. Not all the data, but certainly a lot of the data. And they base this on far-fetched complaints about imagined threats to privacy and doing their best to keep it under wraps. And then I'll wrap up with what I call the cascade effects, why preferences cause Mismatch in almost all selective schools. A lot of people might think, well, you're just talking about Harvard, Yale, and Princeton, and Stanford. No, virtually all, thousands, hundreds anyway. One striking feature of our preferences is its tendency to cascade like a row of dominoes. First, the super elite schools get their pick of the most academically qualified minorities, most of whom might have been better matched at a lower tier school, but they're still very strong students. Indeed, only 1 to 2% of the black college applicants in the country emerge from high school well qualified academically for, say, the top Ivy League colleges or Stanford. Therefore, those super elite schools can meet their racial admissions targets, which in the neighborhood of 10%, I think, black and 10% Hispanic, only by using large preferences and other inducements such as generous financial aid packages. The Ivies and other super elite schools bring in black students who are very well qualified for what I'll call the second tier of still excellent, moderately elite schools like, say, the University of North Carolina. I could name any number of others, but not well qualified for the Ivies. Then the University of North Carolina and the other second-tier schools must choose from a much weaker black applicant pool than if there were no racial preferences. There are a lot of blacks who are well qualified to the University of North Carolina. They're at Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Stanford, University of Chicago, and so on. And so the second-tier schools, they have larger internal gaps between blacks and whites than do the more elite ones. Much larger, actually. And so on down the selectivity school. University of North Carolina gets students who would be well qualified at the University of Missouri, which means they're not available for the University of Missouri. As a result, most black students at almost all selective schools, with high school preparation and test scores far below those of their classmates, rank well below the middle of their college and grad school classes. Now, I was thinking of going on to talk about how Mismatch helps prove racial preferences unconstitutional, and also a couple more stories of individual students like Imani Hall and Jerome Hall, and Imani and Jerome. But I think I'm about out of time, and I'm very interested in hearing your questions. Thanks very much. Now, Professor Strang suggested that I look for people who have questions and call on them, but I'm not that good at seeing people. So if you're having trouble getting my attention and you think it's taken me too long, be conspicuous. Yes, sir.
The two people that you cited who went through trauma, one at Colgate and one at Amherst, are their paradigm of who you're trying to talk about being mismatched. Yet what you told me is that, as far as I know, but rather they hung in there even with their lower grade to get that Colgate degree, and I assume Ms. Amber's degree. With all the feelings of being an imposter, whatever that's there, that degree had some meaning to them. And their agency, their choice to transfer someplace else or stay there and keep going at it, suggests that they see some value in getting those degrees. And so the question I'm asking is, why is it in their interest for you to tell them they shouldn't do this when they think it's in their interest, knowing all they got, that to get that degree?
A very good question, and let me give about two different answers. First, the main reason I'm arguing for in the Supreme Court brief and generally and in our book, the main remedy for the problems I'm describing is full disclosure by every college of all the data and other statistics with privacy protections that would allow prospective applicants as well as the public policymakers to assess the pros and cons. But that's not, and therefore, you know, that's not saying you can't go to Colgate or you can't go to Amherst. That's sort of saying, well, if you want to look at how, you know, other people who had your mix of scores and grades did, you know, here are the numbers. The other response I'd give is these kids had an investment, obviously, in going to Colgate or Amherst. And they were going to graduate. Jerome Hall had to drop out, but he went back and he graduated. And they know they can probably graduate. And so if you're saying, and also it's not human nature to say to yourself, gee, I wasn't really academically prepared to be here, so I should go somewhere else. And so I think it's not, I don't, you know, they tend to stay. I don't think that means that they were better off, or maybe even that they think they were better off than if they had gone to a college for which they were well prepared in the first place. But it is a good question, and I think that's one reason why the remedy I'm most comfortable with is transparency. And you know, it's a form of consumer protection. And I think Ralph Nader might support it. He and I are on a slate of candidates for the Harvard Board of Overseers, and one of the platforms of the slate is transparency about admissions. It's said that at Harvard, they sell seats in the class to underqualified children of parents who give $3 million. It's called the Z List. I'm not sure it's true, but that's part of the problem out there. That's basically what comes to mind. Thank you. Yes, sir.
You mentioned social matters, and one of the benefits of going to some of the elite schools isn't what you're going to learn in class, but the associations you're going to make and maybe contacts that may benefit you the rest of your life. Would that be, if there were a cure for the social problems, and that this factor of the contacts, I mean, would there still be value in going to a better place if you could deal with the social matters separately, with the isolation and that kind of stuff?
Yeah. Well, it's clearly, other things being equal, going to the most prestigious college is going to be a big help to you, in part because of your classmates who are, you know, likely to be in important jobs. And that's all to the good, other things being equal. And other things being equal, having 10% blacks at, say, Harvard rather than 7% or 5% is a benefit to the white and Asian students. Diversity, other things being equal, is a good thing, but other things aren't equal. And one part of the benefit, the supposed benefit to black students, say, or Hispanic students, of being at a place where they have to get admitted through large preferences, you know, the idea that, oh, they're going to rub elbows with the people who are going to go on and become head of Goldman Sachs or the big law firm, well, they're not really rubbing elbows very much, because after maybe the first year survey courses, they're not sitting in the same classrooms. You know, the whites who are in the challenging economics course, the challenging chemistry course, the pre-med things, the engineering things, the science things, there aren't many blacks in those courses because those, and I discussed this, those who wanted to go down those lines, you know, got a D in the first chemistry test and a D in the second chemistry test. And then they went to talk to the professor. I'm just making this up, obviously, but I think it's a type. And he says, you know, maybe, you know, you're not cut out to do chemistry at this university. professor wouldn't go on and say you'd do fine in chemistry at some other university, but that's unsaid. I don't think the professors even think that way. And so maybe you'd be better off majoring in sociology or whatever. If there are sociologists here, I apologize for using you as a type, but I think it's pretty common knowledge that there are very easy gut courses where you can get an A or worse to B, no matter whether you do any work or not, whether you understand what they're talking about or not. Yes, sir.
You make that argument that social, economic, and academic less rigor in high school becomes a disadvantage that really harms minority students. But should there be a vehicle to close that gap, then what would it be?
Well, I think the ultimate solution to the problems we're talking about, which is a very difficult solution, is K-12 schools. It would be wonderful if the academic qualifications of black and white and Asian students coming out of high school were comparable. But we're a very long way from that, and it's not easy to get from here to there. Part of it is school quality, but not all of it is school quality. A lot of it has to do with single parenting, which is more common among some racial groups than others, and which has a very clear effect on educational achievement. And peer group influences. A science teacher told me the following story. There was a school that was tracked in math, and in ninth grade or so, the people who are doing well in math go down this hallway, and the people who are doing not so well go down that hallway to another classroom, and this group is almost all Asian and white, and that group's almost black and Hispanic, and there's one or two or three black kids who have been invited to go in the fast group. And they start to walk down the hall, and their friends say, "Why are you acting white and going down the hall with them?" And then I think part of it is self-driven by preferences. I mentioned, I think, earlier the great linguist, and I'm having trouble with his name, but here's what he wrote. I knew, every black student knows pretty early in school that there's something called affirmative action, and that what it means is we don't have to do as well academically to get into a top college. John McWhorter wrote this. We don't have to do as well to get into a top college. And McWhorter says, I knew that when I was in high school, so I didn't work as hard as I might have worked if I didn't know that. And there's a disincentive to academic achievement when you know you're being judged by a double standard that gives you the benefit. Yes?
Two questions, related questions. My first question is, I'm a little unsure whether you're advocating against affirmative action or against racial preferences. Or you're saying that the United States Supreme Court has misunderstood those terms or misapplied them. My second question is, clearly you made a lot of contact with reviewed articles, and so I did a quick Google search, and it appears that your initial article, which all of your comments have been based off, was not peer reviewed.
The Sander article in Stanford Law Review? Yeah, if I don't remember every part of your question, please remind me, but I'll do my best. Racial preference. The Supreme Court knows perfectly well what it's talking about, and the words that it has used in its major decisions on this are not affirmative action mostly, it's racial preferences. Now, Justice Sotomayor, in a dissent from one of these decisions, the Michigan case, said, oh, no, these aren't racial preferences, but the dissent, it was, what she was saying was not true. So the Supreme Court knows what they're talking about, and if I seem a little ambivalent, it's for two reasons. One, I don't like racial preferences, and I do like affirmative action as it was originally meant. The fact that the two are used synonymously now by a lot of people means, well, I like this and I don't like that, but it all depends on how you define them. When you define affirmative action as meaning special, I support affirmative action, for example, we'll call it preferences, based on economic status. If you have a kid from a lousy high school and his parents are cab drivers and seamstresses and he or she has done spectacularly well academically given those roots, I'm for that kid getting preferences because you can expect that kid maybe to advance. Not huge preferences though, because that would reintroduce the mismatch problem. And the other part, so part of that's just definitional. I support affirmative action as I define it. But part of it is ambivalence. I go back and forth between thinking the Supreme Court should just ban racial preferences, and the state should, in admissions, you know, in state programs, and thinking no transparency makes more sense. And one reason I go to transparency sometimes is that I think it'd be more effective. I think it would have a revolutionary impact if all this data were made public and if all the secrets that are being kept were blown away. The reason I sometimes go to the ban is all school administrators are prisoners of this system. If the dean of any law school in the country or the president of any university in the country stood up and said, you know, I've read this thing by Taylor and Sander and it makes a lot of sense to me, maybe we should stop using racial preferences, he or she would be gone in a week, maybe 2 weeks. It is forbidden to say a lot of the things I'm saying if you're employed on a college campus. I'm not employed on a college campus. I did teach a course at Stanford Law School in 2011 and 2012. But, you know, I'm and Sander is employed on a college campus, but he knows perfectly well, I think, that he would never get tenure again anywhere. He has it at UCLA Law School because of his work. And so when I think, you know, we're all prisoners of a system that no individual can escape, that no university can escape on its own, even if it wants to, and they don't want to mainly, I think, you know, the only way to break this system is a ban of some kind. Now, your other question went to the peer review thing. And you're correct. I don't think it says on Rick Sander's law review article that it's peer reviewed. And I've said to him, you know, well, what about your, you know, and he says it was peer reviewed in the sense that a couple of econometricians who know the relevant statistical fields better than he does reviewed it and commented on it, and it was peer reviewed in that sense. It doesn't say so there because I think it's very rare for law review articles to say this was peer-reviewed. Law review articles aren't typically peer-reviewed, and or at least even if they are, it doesn't say that they were. And most of the critiques of mismatch theory have been law review articles. Sir.
All right, just to clarify a few things, speaking from the perspective of a black male in America. I'll frame this two ways. First and foremost, speaking about scholars getting together, great legal minds, even the Supreme Court, those great minds coming together have made horrible decisions for people that look like me historically over the years. So that doesn't hold much weight when you keep talking about the areas of professionals that you work with on these issues. Secondly, out of anything that you mentioned that blacks in law school may learn less. And it is not, in fact, that we learn less. What happens is when you're conscious as a black person, you live a reality. And if you come into law school and you learn, you see laws in the system that negatively affects you and those that look like you, not only currently, but historically. But you must take this information, digest it, and regurgitate it in a way that the law school wants to see, which is not always an easy thing to do when you walk out of these doors and again go back to the very reality that some of us are here to try and counteract. So when you speak of things such as intellectual self-confidence, nothing about this curriculum affects my intellectual self-confidence. I have to tap into the utmost of my intellect to even process this matter without being outraged certain days about what I learn, what I see, and how I see it applied for my people.
Shall I answer? Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate your candor, and those are good questions. Here are my answers. The first point you made is that scholars have made terrible decisions over many, many years that turned out badly for black people. You bet. Guess where most of the scholars are on this question. The entire university system, courtroom system, government system, educational system in the United States as almost one voice supports racial preferences. Those are the people who are prescribing, as I see it, bad things for people of your race. I think the scholars that I'm talking about, who are a minority among scholars, but maybe a majority among scholars who have done careful empirical research, I think what they, I mean, you could argue that making it transparent, for example, would be bad for people of your race, but I can at least say that the weight of scholarly opinion, I would call it ignorant, you know, most scholars in this country support racial preferences, and so I'm not sure that your concern speaks exactly what I'm talking about. Second, black people don't learn less. I hope I didn't say black people learn less. And I hope I did say that, as far as I know, there's no particular use of racial preferences at this university or this law school. I don't know exactly what the system is, but I'm guessing from what little I know that nobody bent any rules to admit you to this law school, because that's, you know, that's something that is done at a lot of schools. And by the way, there are black students at a lot of schools, particularly at the very top schools, who would be admitted without consideration of race. And therefore, I think there you're contradicting a point that I didn't make and try very hard not to make. Now, if you're outraged by what they're teaching, then when you have to do an exam or speak out in class, you have a decision to make whether you're going to talk about your outrage or whether you're going to feed them what, you know, the analytical thing that that they've given you. And frankly, you know, I can't put myself in your position. I remember my first year contracts exam, my professor, who is the prototype for the paper chase, Dr. Kingsfield, threw out a question about the parole evidence rule. And it was some little guy who ran a corner store, and he was being ruined by the big corporation, and they were using the parole evidence rule to ruin him. And, you know, I could tell that the professor, Clark Bice, who was, you know, he was trying to sucker people into saying, oh, I'm with the poor little guy who's being ruined by the big corporation. And my instinct went that way, too, but I also knew perfectly well that it was a trick. And that the parole evidence rule in that case should have applied. And so I just wrote what I thought was the kind of analysis he was looking to hear. And I didn't sort of think, oh, do I really think this is the side that ought to win? Now, that's a choice people make when they decide their strategy on what to say in an exam. And I wouldn't have done that in class. If I thought the professor was saying something in class that I disagreed with, I would tell him. But blind graded exams, you know, my strategy was play by their rules and use your opportunities elsewhere to play by your rules. Sir.
So in response to the lady's question back there, you said you don't like affirmative racial preferences.
Racial preferences.
So, and would like to give it those. So would you say have that same feeling towards instances of nepotism among students that are able to get into universities just because their parents might big checks? And how do you feel about that? And another question I have for you is, many studies show that affirmative action benefits white people more than African Americans. And I just want to know,
thank you for that question, those questions. I oppose preferences based on wealthy parents giving a lot of money. I also oppose what's called legacy preferences, alumni preferences. I went to Princeton, so should my son, daughter get a preference applying to Princeton. I oppose those. One reason I don't talk about that so much is that the big dollar preferences, you know, it's a handful of students. If I get on the Harvard Board of Overseers, I'll raise hell about that, but it's not something I devote a lot of attention to. On the legacy preferences, I oppose them, but they don't pose a huge mismatch problem as far as I've seen, because usually they're pretty light finger on the scale. For example, I had lunch with a friend who's been teaching at Princeton for the last 7 years and living in a dorm and hanging out with the president and knows his way around. And he said, you know, the the alumni kids have higher SAT scores on average than the class as a whole. He also said, you know, about half of the black kids who are here at Princeton do pretty well, and they're fine, and about half of them just can't hack it academically here, and they're kind of sad. That's what he said, one person's observation. Yes?
This is our last question, make it short.
Okay, sorry.
I just saw an article this morning about the University of Connecticut setting up a black male residence hall in an attempt to say, let's bring those folks together that are here that are struggling and haven't even lived in essentially what is segregated housing. It seems to me that obviously there are two people very upset about that, but on the other hand, you're sort of implying that maybe that's socially, if that helps those students by being together, just like here at UT, we have people who live in engineering residence halls and social science residence halls. That's the argument the University of Connecticut is making. I was wondering if you had any comment about that.
Yeah, well, I think it's a terrible idea to have racially themed residence halls or anything else. Now, if black students want to hang out together and they have the black table at the lunchroom where people understand that this is black people, or if they want to cluster together with a bunch of their friends and all go to the same dorm, that's fine, that's self-selection. But when it's the university saying, yeah, no, you go to the black dorm, the question one university official memorably raised about it was, and should we have black and white water fountains too? Are you thinking about this, fellas, when you suggest this? And one of the people I interviewed for Mismatch was a very successful doctor who had gone to Wesleyan. And he said when he got to Wesleyan, they put him in the black-themed dorm. And he almost flunked out because the people in the black-themed dorm who he hung out with, didn't approve of him doing any academic work. And he said when he got out of the black-themed dorm is when he took off academically and ended up being an eminent physician. His name escapes me because I think we quoted him by name, or I would name him, but it's in the book.
Thank you, everybody, for a robust, respectful debate.
Thank you. Appreciate the courtesy. I very much appreciate all of the questions. They were courteous.